We are about to study the Mishnah, which according to the Rambam, it's a mitzvah kvot Yom Tov, which means that it's a mitzvah to honor Yom Tov, the festival. And it's divrei Kabbalah, which means that this is a tradition that we receive, versus the Rif and the Rosh say that it's just a way that we continue the discussion of Mishnayot. But also, we're going to discuss today the end of the Sukkot, which means how exactly a person should go about to unload it and take out everything from his Sukkah. Then, times allow, we'll discuss a little bit the disputation between the old-time Christianity and Judaism that happened over the time, but here we're back at 1800 years ago, the time of the Talmud. And then, if times allow, we'll go to the subject of a altar, ancient altars, Canaanite altars, a Jewish altars, and the service of the festival of Sukkot. So we are on page 48, the first Mishnah. Ha-halel ve-asimcha shmona keitzad. So it means here is no difference between Shmini Atzeret, the other festival of Sukkot, and the rest of the week. Number one, the recitation of the Hallel, meaning Hallelujah, the praising of the Almighty, is part of the decorum of service on Sukkot. So the obligation to recite Hallel and the mitzvah to rejoice, there is a special mitzvah to rejoice during the festival, which means they eating the peace offering and the act of the celebrations. It's always 8 days. That's based on the Mishnah we studied on page 42. Keitzad, how a person should go about with following those important commandments. מלמד שחייב אדם באמירה, בהלל ובשמחה ובכבוד יום טוב אחרון של חג, כי שאר כל ימות החג. It teaches us that the person have the obligation to recite a halel, meaning to praise God, and to be active with the mitzvah, the commandment of rejoicing and honoring the last day of the festival, which is the Shmini Atzeret, the same as all the other 7 days of the holidays. Menan emile, how do you know that the mitzvah of being in a celebration, being a rejoicement, applied to the 8 day of the Shmini Atzeret? The Tanu Rabbanan, because the rabbis teaches us in a braita. The Torah said, Book of Dvarim, chapter 16. Shivat yamim tachog la Hashem Elokecha. 7 days you celebrate to your Lord, your God. And then the Torah said, Ve'ayita ach sameach. You should always be in an act of happiness. Express your joyful. So the question is, why you need to repeat yourself? Earlier we said, V'samachta bechagecha, you should be happy. I assume everyone knows that song, right? You should be rejoiced and happy in the festival. So why need to repeat again, right? So they said, L'rabot leile yom tov acharon. It's come to teach us the eve of Shmini Atzeret, that you have the mitzvah of simcha, to be happy the 7 days before that. So it means also, as far as taking the peace offering, it's applied also the night that close to the 8th day of the Sukkot. And they said, "Oh, eino ela yom tov harishon." You may say that that's applied only to the first day. So the answer is, "Kshehu omer ach." When they use the word ach, it's mi'ut, which means that to circumscribe the meaning chilek, which means it's divided the mitzvah of simcha, the rejoicement, only after the other, which means that's the eve of the last day of Sukkot. מה ראית לרבות ליום טוב האחרון להוציא לי טוב הראשון? Why you, so you have in addition the last day of the festival? לרבי אני ליום טוב האחרון שיש שמחה לפניו. הוא מוציא לי ליום טוב הראשון שאין שמחה לפניו. Obviously, before the festival of Sukkot, there's no mitzvah of Sukkah. Versus the last one, you already rejoiced for 7 days. So the truth of the matter, למעשה, we have two ימים טובים, two festivals. Which is a zman simcha, a time to be happy, to rejoice, and during the day you have the korbanot, the offering, but in the eve, so the whole idea of eating meat in the eve of the festival, which means it's called shalmei simcha, the food, the meat of the peace offering, that's applied to what? To the last day? Or to, so here, Lema'et, it's come to teach us that Shalmei Simcha, the celebration, the celebratory of a peace offering, it's in the eve of the eighth, which means this, the end of the seventh day, the beginning of the eighth day of Sukkot. So let's first wrap up this Mishnah, what we study. So we study in this Mishnah the concluding of the seventh day of Sukkot. That's the whole idea. When a person's finish the very end, we have the mitzvah of what? Of Hallel, and the mitzvah of eating the meat offering. Sukkah Shiva. So now the Mishnah continue in elaboration of the previous one. And they said the mitzvah of the Sukkah is 7 days. Ketzad. How? What we do at the 7 day? Gamar milechol lo yatir et sukkato. So if you look at this beautiful illustration, a person finished eating at the Sukkah, he is not allowed to take off the sukkah. So,
take off the schach or?
Take off the schach and then obviously moving the fanot, the walls of the sukkah. And the idea is that the mitzvah is applied to the end of the day. And if he wants to study or wants to sleep, and or he needs to have another seuda, all of a sudden people show up and he wants to have guests, so Rashi said it's a problem to do it at the last day. Now the Meiri said that it's some type of bizui mitzvah, which is an important concept in halacha, that you show that you can't wait to see the festival is over. You know what does that mean? Imagine, my Rebbe used to say, people were standing when it's not, Shabbos is not over, especially in the summertime, and they're waiting with their watches and they can't wait to see the Shabbos is over, right? Which is a huge celebration. And instead of appreciating that, they have to rush to make it up. Or you see people davening and they can't wait to see the davening is over, you know? So the Meiri said, the same manner is that the Sukkot is not over yet, and you start taking off the schach and taking off the dfanot. It's a pre-cut all, it's bizui mitzvah. It means that you are just show that you want to get rid of that. Aval morid et hakelim min ha-mincha ulemala. Since in those days they used to build the Sukkah, which we nowadays call above attic or the roof place.
On the rooftop, yeah.
Yes, so a person can take from his sukkah to his house some utensils, etc. From what? From mincha ulemala, from the time of the mincha, which means that is mincha ktana, 2.5 hours before sunset, that's the ritva said. Because Rashi tells us that the person needs to bring the most beautiful linen and sheets and blankets to his sukkah. It's like ke'ein tadur, that you feel that you're dwelling in a sukkah. So from the time of mincha, 2.5 hours, mincha ktana, you can take it out. Why? You need to prepare for what? Mipnei kvod yom tov acharon shel chag. You want to honor the last day of the festival. So the whole act of preparation is act of the upcoming Yom Tov, and that's proper. Just let's wrap up the Mishnah. The Mishnah tells us that the idea of the concluding of the 7 days of Sukkot, which is the whole idea of Sukkah Shiva. So when a person finishes eating his last meal, he should not take the sukkah down. That's the point one. However, he brings the vessels down after mincha to honor the last day of the festival. And then the Gemara here follow up with a question. The question is, Ein lo kelim lohorid mahu. So Rashi tells us here beautifully. He said, "Maya selochiach sheino mosif al mitzvah lasot sukkah shmona yamim." So the question is, what? How a person that doesn't have those utensils, what exactly he needs to do in order to take out the sukkah? This Rashi said, "Makom acher lechol sham." There's not now other place to eat there. Ein lo kelim ela b'mayishtamesh, b'mayishtamesh. So it means, what exactly he needs to do that this to show that the mitzvah of the sukkot ended at that time. Ela ein lo makom lohorid kelav. So he doesn't have another place to eat the last day of Sukkot, and he needs, by force of circumstance, to eat in a sukkah. What exactly the din? How do we, a person know, as Rashi tells us, that he is not adding of the sukkah? There is a mitzvah of bal tosif. A person should not add more than the Torah commanded. And the question is, how you do that, in one hand to eat there, on the other hand that you not add more than Hashem asks us to do. Rav Chiya Barashi Amar, Pochet ba'arba'ah. So guess what do? You go to the schach, you make a hole in the schach, in the size of 4 hand breadth by 4 hand breadth. So therefore you make the sukkah invalid. Right? Because the air is by 3 of 3. You remember we talked about it. So therefore, then you can go ahead and use it. So that's one way, which means if he doesn't have a place for his kelim, what did he do? The Rav Chiya Barashi said he removes the 4x4 tfachim, and therefore invalidating the sukkah. Point one. V'Rabbi Yoshua ben Levi amar madlik ba etaner. So basically, doing this Sukkot, a person light the candles. It's the issue to light the candles there, because you have to do it outside of the sukkah. Then we apply it for sure to the minimum size of the sukkah. So he said, a person that light the candles, he proved that he is not intent to stay, to dwell there. So the Gemara elaborated that. Velo plige. This is not a disputation between the two Amoraim. Why? Halan vehalehu. So Mishnah Berurah said that it's not really a real baltosi. Why? Because there is a rule that difference between mitzvah bizmana, to do the mitzvah on time and not on his time. the eighth day, it's not bizmana, it's not on time. So it's not a real bal tosif. Because otherwise, the eighth day is the issue of that. But the answer here is said that we have to differentiate between people here, meaning in exile, that we are not sure when is the exact day of Rosh Chodesh. So therefore, we are the Shmini Atzeret, because it's Safek Shvi'i, we're not sure what exact is the day. V'halehu, over there, of Chiyabarashi, it's Eretz Yisrael, that they don't have an issue of the exact time of the month. So therefore, it can make the Sukkah invalid the seventh day by reducing the four tfachim, the four hand breadth from the Schach. So the Meiri said, when they have the four tfachim is minka, you recognize it. So, that's the point between the two. One applied to people outside of Israel and the others. Hateinach lesukah ktana. What the question is, what if it is that's applied to a small sukkah, but what if it is a large sukkah? So the 7x7 is the minimum one. But the sukkah gdula ma'ika le'meimar, how do you deal with the large sukkah? So the answer is the me'ayel b'mani meichla, that they bring in post to wash to be michutz la'sukkah. So he bring there some food and utensil that's not clean. The marava manei mechla, those utensils, bar mimiklala, mimitalalta, which means excluding those utensils that you have to take it out of the sukkah, because, as you know, imagine that you have those pots that finish the food, the meal, and it was not clean afterward. So over the time, it's like very unpleasant, like disgusting, those things. So nemane mishtiya, however, those cups just for drink, bim talalta, because that's not something that you don't like to have. Now the next mishnah, we're going to speak about Nisuch HaMayim. So there are a few points I would like to introduce before we go to this Mishnah. We learned at the beginning of the chapter that the libation of the water needs to be all the 7 days of the festival. Now, the Prima Gadin tells us that that it's not only biblical, follow what the Gemara said in Zvachim 110, but he said that that's even as much as biblical, it's not clear. One opinion said that it's Alacha LeMoshe MiSinai, that this tradition received from Moses and Sinai. And others said that you derive it from the offering of the additional offering of the festival. The reason it's a famous Tosefta, the Gemara said in Rosh Hashanah of 16, that Hashem said, Naschu lefanai mayim b'chag ha-sukkot, put the libation of water before me in the festival of Sukkot, kedei shiitbarchu lachem gishmei shana, in order to have the blessing of the water in the year. So for sure you have some rabbis that said that that's one of the esoteric power, that from the heaven and the earth, the connection with the water, bring the water as a result of like the controlling over the future blessing of the water and the rain, depend upon how do you do things here. But anyway, is a question what exactly involved with that libation. Some say that it's part of the daily offering. Some said that no, it's nothing to do with daily offering, it's just for that day, Chovat Hayom. So, but the Rambam said that that's specifically during the day and not at night, just during the day. But here the Prima Gadim asked, what exactly happened here? In one hand, we ended the previous Mishnah, and we said, you tell me that I should sit on the eighth day, and by the same token, they tell me to take off part of the Sukkah. So he said basically two explanations. One, he said that outside of Eretz Yisrael, the person needs to see that is not so familiar with Kviya Diyarcha, is not so familiar when exactly is the time of the festival. And the second point, the Prima Gadim said that it's all Takanat Sofrim, that it's all because you're not so sure to dwell on the Sukkah or not, so therefore that's the reason for that. So that's answer the your question. Now let's go back to our Mishnah. The Mishnah said, Nisuch HaMayim Keitzad Tzlochit Shel Zahav Machzeket Shlosha Lugim Haya Memale Min HaShiloach. So again, the Shiloach is the river close to Yerushalayim, and here is a nice illustration. They said that they take the Tzlochit Shel Zahav, fill the golden jug with a canopy of 3 log of water from a, it's called Shiloach or a Siloam pool. Ve'igiu le'shar ha'mayim, they entered the gate of water. So because the water of libation was brought to the gate leading to the Beit HaMikdash Kol courtyard, tak'u ve'eriu ve'tak'u. They blow the shofar and they do it several times. That's act of simcha, act of happiness. Ala ba'kevesh ufana lismolo. So the Kohen go to the ram, ascend to the ramp of the altar and turn to his left. Shnei sfalim shel kesef hayu sham. There were 2 silver basins that they put the water. Rabbi Yehuda omer shel sidayu, ela shehu mushcharim mipnei hayayin. The Buddha said that they are limestone basin, but they turned to be black because it was wine. So it looked like silver. Umenukavim, the 2 basins were perforated at the bottom. Kemim shnei chotamim dakim. And 48b, and there are 2 thin perforated nose-like and ve'echad me'ube ve'echad dak kedei shiyu shnehem kalim bevad achad. One, it's a thin, and one, it was a large one, and they made it in order that they are both conclude simultaneously. Ma'aravo shel mayim, the mizracho shel yayin, eastern part for the for libation of water. The western part, the eastern part is for the wine. Eira shel mayim letoch shel yayin, veshel yayin letoch shel mayim yatzah. When he combined, we poured the content of basin of water into the basin of wine, and the other way around, so he fulfilled the obligation. Now he said, Rabbi Yehuda omer belog haya menasech kol shmona. Rabbi Yehuda said that the basin of the water libation was not that large. Rather, one poured the water with a vessel that had the capacity of 1 log of all 8 days of the festival, and not only 7. Velam nasech omrim lo, and the one who does that, the appointee, said, Hagbe yadcha, lift up your hand when you do this libation, so you see the water on the altar. שפעם אחת ניסח אחד על גבי רגליו ורגמו כל אדם באתרוגיהם. You know that story, that was one time a fellow that did it, it was a tzedoki, a Sadducees, that he intentionally, that Kohen, poured the water on the feet, because as you know, we said several times, that tzedokim did not accept the oral Torah that required the water libation. So therefore, they stone him, people throw the etrogim on him, and it was a big to-do. If you remember, this Gemara we studied in Yuma 26, that it was a bizayon, it was a very unpleasant moment. There are those who said it cannot be with the etrogim, that people throw stone on him and kill him, but anyway. כמעשהו בחול, כך מעשהו בשבת. The same way as happened during the week, that you do the libation of water, do the same on Shabbat. אלא, שהיה ממלא מערב שבת חבית של זהב שאינה מקודשת מן השילוח. That he filled up a jar, golden jar, from the Shiloach river, ומניחה בלשכה, and he put it in a special chamber, and then the next day, in Shabbat morning, he filled that golden one, נשפחה נתגלתה, if it's poured, and during Shabbat, you see that there's no water for libation, היה ממלא מן הכיור, he filled up from the basin, שהיין והמים מגולים, פסולים לגבי מזבח. Because he said that when you have this, the wine and the water, they are exposed, it's unfit for the water. So just as it is prohibited for people to drink them due to the potential danger, the same way they may not be poured on the altar. Amar av menan emile, how do you learn that? Amar av ein ad amar kra, ושאבתם מים בססון. So here, we have here a discussion that soon you see it a lot of time in the Gemara, that it's like some sort of a heavy disputation or unpleasant disputation between the best, I think, it can be the early Christianity, but you can say that was other group of heretic, but it was a discussion between the two heretics. Hanu trei mine, it was two people who are heretics. Chad shmei Sason v'chad shmei Simcha. One his name is Sason and one his name is Simcha. Omar l'Sason l'Simcha, ana adif naminach. Dechtiv Sason v'Simcha yasigu. The one said, the others, I am better than you, because it's written, Sason v'simcha are rich. Amar le'simcha v'son, ana adif naminach, dechtiv, simcha v'son edim, just read in the book of Esther. So, amar le'i, Sason v'simcha, chad yom al shavkuk v'shavich parvrakna. So, one day, they from heaven, they put it down from your greatness, and you'll be the one who run before people. Dechtiv ki besimcha tetzeu. So amar lei simcha l'sason chad yom ha'shavkuch u'ma lo abach maya. So one day they fill up your hand with water. Dechtiv u'shavte mayim besason. So the Maharsha tells us that showed the lack of understanding, the limited of understanding. There was a place we several times mentioned, Be'avidan, the place that those heretics have a club, for the best description, that they disputed the sages. But here we see another example. Amar le'aumina d'shmei d'sason l'rabbi Abau. Atila Elmina, the Shmei Sason Rabbi Abau, is a certain heretic, said by the name of Sason, he said to Rabbi Abau, Atidinit Malulimaim La'alma De'ate. You, Jews, are going to dwell water for me in the world to come. דכתיב, ושאבתם מים בססון. אמר לי, רבי אבא, הספנדו, אם יבא, כתיב לססון, כדי כאמר. If it's written לססון. השתא דכתיב בססון, with bet. משחידה, הוא גבר, משמין לגודה, מלין על בימהלה. So from that skin of that person, they filled up a wine skin, and he will draw water with him. So literally speaking, that he answered in his language. He belittled the whole concept of afterlife or resurrection, and he answered. But there is a book that Dr. Berger, you know, the Dr. David Berger from from Brooklyn, from Yeshiva University, he wrote extensively over this. So one of his book, I think you'll find it here in the library, it's called Nitzachon. I think the spelling is N-I-T-Z-C-H-O-N. So in that book, he elaborates a lot on those discussions. Who are this group? How exactly they disputed the rabbis? What exactly involved with those discussions? So again, the simple way is that the is like answering back. For sure, there are some books that go in more mystical explanation of all these discussions, but we don't go there. Next, Mishnah said, "Ala b'kevesh ufana lesmolo." So the Kohen ascended the ramp of the altar and turned to his left. Tanu rabanan, kol ha'olim la'mizbeach olim derech yamin, makifin ve'yordin derech smol. All those who go around the altar, so they go ascend to the right and circle the altar and descend to the left. Chutz min ha'olel l'shlosha dvarim halalu, sholim derech smol, excluding the one who comes for three things, use the left way to make it. Chozrim al ha'akev, the return, the same way as they come in. So by the way, there is a place, you know, in one of the settlements in the West Bank, it's called Shiloh. Close to that settlement, they found, it's called Givat Arel, a place that as you know, it's a conflict, etc. So some people there, they respond to the conflict. The next day, what they do, they start building settlement. Just the usual response.
Is it the same location as the historical Shiloh?
That's what they claim. But anyway, some claim. But so they build there a small settlement, Givat Arel, and before they knew it, it's a huge altar. They found a huge altar. So right away they called the archaeologists because there's a lot of evidence there. And eventually they said it wasn't Jewish, it was a Canaanite one, because the Jewish altar has a certain way that's based on this Gemara, certain way that they made it. Ve'eluen, these are the three things, nisuach ha-maim, ve'nisuach ha-yayin, ve'olat ha-ov, k'sheravta ba-mizbeach. He's talking about the libation of water, wine, and olat ha-ov, that applies to the burn offering, that they do it in the east part of the altar. So they say, Rabbi Yehuda said, Ela shayu mashchirim. Rabbi Yehuda says that when it was the limestone, not silver, but they were blackened due to the wine, because it looks like a silver. Bishlama diayin mashchir. The maya amay mashchir. What's the reason that the water, we understand is wine make it black, but what's the water? Kevan damar mar, we said the Mishnah, if he switch, ira shel ma'im letoch shel yain, v'shel yain letoch shel ma'im yatsa. If one, a pour the content of basin of water into the basin of wine, and the content of the basin of wine to a basin of water, he fulfilled his obligation. So he said, Shel Maim Adila Ashkhuri. So then even the basin of water would come to blacken the, over the course of time as well. So he said, Menukavim kemin shnei chotamim. So the two basins are perforated at the bottom of the two things. Lema matnin Rabbi Yudai velo Rabbanan. May say that this part of the Mishnah applied to Rabbi Yudai, not the sages. Ditnan Rabbi Yudai omer, belog haya menasech kol shmona. Rabbi Yudai said that the vessel that contained log, he put the libation of water all the 8 days of the festival. The I Rabbanan ki had that they minu, they are equal. So why those holes different in the size? Afilu tema Rabbanan chamra smich maya klish. The wine is thick and the water is thin, so therefore the wine flows more slowly than water. Hachi name mistabra. That's the way we understand. The I Rabbi Yuda, if you go by Rabbi Yuda, Rachav Vekatzar Itle. So I explained in my book, B'yura Klomar, B'Rashi El Hashas. Rashi here tells us, Rachav Vekatzar Itle, Klomar Sham Ilan Levelashon Echad Rachav Echad Katzar. So Rashi said that the difference, the chiluk, between Rachav and Katzar, long and short, it's larger than one that aven dak, that is thick or larger one. Rabbi Yudah Omer, Netanya, Rabbi Yudah Omer, Shnei Kasvaot Ayusha, Buddha said the two vessels were there, Echad Shel Mayim, Echad Shel Yayin, one for libation of water, and one for libation of wine. Shel Yayin Pi Arachav, Shel Mayim Pi Akatzak, Yushvei Kirvim Evat Echad, Shma Minah. So that's basically the bottom line that we follow Rabbi Yudah. Now, it's a side note. I want you to know that this combination of water and the wine, you see it in several occasions. For example, in Sheva Brochas, right after the Chuppah, we have Sheva Brochas, and then we have the Chatun, the dancing, and then we have the Birkat HaMazon. Following Birkat HaMazon, we have Sheva Brochas. So why we combine? If you see the two cups, we combine them. And some add some, a little bit water. So adding the water, usually it's more Kabbalistic. It's the whole idea of act of attribute of judgment, act of attribute of mercy, combination. But the combining the two water, it's because there is a concept of pagum. There is a wine, the moment you drink from the cup, it's less chashivut, it's take away some of the importance of the wine. So you have one that you use for Birkat HaMazon, that you say the bracha of Bor Pri Hagafen, one you use for Sheva Brachot. So that's the story, you're combining the two. Another important point here, you talk about using a water, and you're using water to dilute it. You see it in several places in the Talmud. So it's a two school of thought. I want you both to know that both school of thoughts are right. So it's hard for me to determine who is right, who is wrong. One school of thought said that at that time, about 1800 years ago, in Galilee, the act of the wine was so strong, meaning that you cannot drink it without diluting it. And the point is that it's even one time a discussion if you drink wine without diluting it, it's a machloket if you fulfill the obligation, and if you need to say the bracha, fulfill it. So the point is, that school of thought said that you cannot compare wine from Galilee today, from Golan Heights, from Galilee today, to wine over there. It's a two different, I don't know if it's the right term, but quality maybe, of wine, or strength of wine. It's like drinking wine of, who knows, 40% of alcohol, which is hard to imagine nowadays. Another school of thought said, that's ridiculous. The other school of thought said that by physics, if you go by the way that it's, you know, it's the same property, it's the same land, yes, 1800 years passed. It can be that all of a sudden, wine that you produce now, what is it, 13-14.5% or something like that from Galilee, and all right, it's good to put some water to dilute it, you know, but to tell me that it, in a measurement that the Talmud speaks, like sometimes three quarter of water to the little wine, or half and a half, which nowadays if you do that, it's totally diluted and take away. It's like you're drinking a juice. So they try to say that either it's because of the poverty, so they cannot afford, or they try to say that there are other reasons. So as I said before, there are two schools of thought, what exactly involved with diluting the wine with the water. It's not clear. I'm personally, even it's not so logical physics, in a sense of physics, I personally am more comfortable with the idea that was a different quality. But you can go ahead and say that there are other reasons, not that the wine itself changed from 18 years ago to now. Anyway, now we talk about Bemaravo Shel Mayim. That was a basin that was in the western part, designated for water. So we read in the Mishnah that one time they make the libation on his feet. Tanu Rabbanan, Maseh B'Tzdoki Echad Sheniseh Al Gabei Raglav. It was one Tzdoki, the Sadducee priest, who put the water on his feet. Urgamu kol ha'am be'etrogehem. And the people who were angry pelted him with their etrogim. Ve'oto ha'yom nifgema keren ha'mizbeach. And that day the horn of the altar was damaged as a result of the pelting and ensuing chaos. Because it was a big, large chaos. ויביאו בול של מלח וסתמוהו. So they bought a salt and sealed the damaged section. לא מפני שהוכשר לעבודה, not because the altar is fit for the temple service, אלא מפני שלא יראה המזבח פגום. They did it in order to show the מזבח, the altar is not deficient. So, according to Chacham Tzvi, this comes to teach us the measurement that makes this pasul invalid. Shekol mizbeach she'en lo, just in page 49, few lines. Lo kevesh, velo keren, velo yesod, velo ribua. As any altar that lacks a ramp, or a horn, or a base, pasul avoda, or the shape of square, it's either because it's not erected as a square, or due to the damage, is disqualified for use in temple service. Rabbi Yossi Bar Yehuda omer afasovev. Rabbi Yossi Bar Yehuda said, even the surrounding ledge must be complete, and it is lacking. It disqualified the altar. So basically what you see here, it's you see that all the four part of the altar me'akev, it's make the reduce the part of the altar. You see the four corners, you see in those illustrations, and that's basically me'akev, make it a problem to use it for the altar. Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 644. Hallel is recited in its complete form during the 7 days of Sukkot and on the 8th day of assembly, and the blessing is recited before Hallel, both communally and individually. There is a positive mitzvah that by Torah law is to rejoice during the 7 days of Sukkot and the 8th day of assembly. Although the rejoicing in the Torah involves bringing peace offerings, included in the mitzvah is a person and the members of his family rejoicing in any appropriate manner. That's Shulchan Aruch HaRachaim 6:69. Now, we discussed a little bit Sukkah, the last day of Sukkot. After the morning meal on the seventh day of Sukkot, one may not dismantle the Sukkah. However, in the late afternoon, one may remove all the vessels that were used therein to prepare for the eighth day of assembly. If he has nowhere to place the vessel and he wished to eat in a Sukkah on the eighth day as well, he must remove a 4x4 handbreadth section, arba arba tfachim, of the roofing as a conspicuous indicator that the sitting in the sukkah is not to fulfill the mitzvah of the sukkah. So that's basically Shulchan Aruch HaRachaim 666. Nisu Chamayim, so it said the libation of water, it's performed on the altar of each of the 7 days of Sukkot. That's the Halacha LeMoshe MiSinai. The water is poured each morning together with the wine libation, each in its own specific location, and accompanying the daily morning offering. That's the Rambam, Hilchot Midim U'Musafim, chapter 10. We talk about Nisuch HaMayim B'Shabbat. The ritual of the water libation was performed on Shabbat, as it was conducted during the week, except that when the libation was performed on Shabbat, they filled the golden barrel that was not of the consecrated temple vessel and placed it in a chamber on Friday. On the next day, Shabbat, they filled the pitcher with the water and pour it on the altar. If the water in the barrel spilled or was exposed, they would fill the pitcher with water from the temple basin and pour it. That's the Rambam, Hilchot Midim U'Musafim, chapter 10. Now we discuss that the last halacha, Aliyah ve'akafa b'mizbeach, ascending and circling the water. All those who climb the altar ascend on the right side, circle the altar, and descend on the left, with three exceptions. Those three rituals are the wine libation, the water libation, and the bird sacrifice as the burnt offering. For those three elements of the temple service performed at the southwest corner of the altar, the Kohen climbs the ramp to the ledge of the altar and immediately turns left to the southwest corner, performs the service, and descends the way he ascended. The reason he does not circle the altar with these three items before the service is due to the concern lest the wine or water become tainted, or lest the birds suffer from the smoke of the bird of the fire as he circled the altar. So the one who elaborates on that is the Rambam in Ilchot Maaseh Korbanot, chapter 7.
Shuloim, Malachai, Shuloim, Malachai.